Welcome to Microsoft Mechanics. Coming up on the show, if you're in IT and want to understand more about the design and architecture of containers and how you can use them, I'm joined by Mark Russinovich to take a look at the latest in containerization and your options. We'll review what containers are and how they work, including the new native container technology in Windows Server 2016, and how this extends to Hyper-V and Microsoft Azure. So I'm joined by Mark Russinovich. Welcome.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
Now, container technology has been around for a while in Linux, but this is something relatively new to Windows.
That's right. We've been working on integrating container support into Windows Server 2016. Mm-hmm. And you might be familiar with some of the work we've been doing with Docker to make sure that Docker works with both Linux containers as well as Windows containers.
Yep. So to take a step back, though, for people who aren't familiar with what containers are all about, help us understand just what containers are.
Sure. So most people are familiar with hardware virtualization, where the operating system creates the illusion that there's a machine in which another operating system runs. With containers, we create the illusion or perception that there's a dedicated installation of Windows in which to host the application, though the application is sharing an underlying operating system with other applications.
Okay, so this is not necessarily using Hyper-V technology the same as we have in the past. Hardware virtualization, this is something completely new for us.
That's right, and some people consider this a lightweight approach to application hosting, though it's not lightweight in terms of necessarily the size of the application
right.
that you want to run.
So it's not restricted to very small applications.
Right. It could be.
Okay, cool. So how does it work?
Yeah, so Windows consists of user mode processes as well as system processes. And what we've done in Windows Server 2016 is enlighten kernel mode so that it can support the operation of multiple copies of or instances of user mode. We've done things like make enhancements to the memory manager, the file system, device drivers, and the scheduler. We've also added two forms of isolation. One is namespace isolation, where each container running user mode sees its own file system and registry. And the other one is resource isolation, where we can have those processes controlled with respect to how much CPU they use, how much network bandwidth they use, and so on.
So what's the big advantage for that type of approach, that isolation?
So you get a few advantages out of this. One is that if you create an application and deploy it into a container, because it has a very fixed environment, regardless of what server it's running on, it'll run reproducibly. So it makes it very easy to move applications around from server to server and have a high degree of assurance that they're going to work.
Okay.
And the second is, because they're sharing this operating system underneath, these user mode processes don't need to boot kernel mode. That's already what they're going to be sharing from the underlying hosting environment. And so that means your application is going to start up that much faster.
And you get a lot of efficiency from that. So if you wanted to scale out an application, it would be incredibly quick.
That's right. You get efficiency from the startup. And then because there are all the applications you put on the same host are sharing the same operating system, you can pack more applications onto that because they're sharing this.
And as a developer, I can move container images from my local workstation that I've been working on. I can push them to the cloud. I can push them somewhere else in the data center.
That's right. On my laptop, which might be a little meek compared to the servers in the data center.
It is a lovely laptop, yeah. though.
And I've got my own development environment running on it. I can take that same container, move it onto a server where there might be dozens or hundreds of other containers on a much beefier server and have, again, be confident that it's going to work great.
So now we understand a little bit more about containers. Can you show us how easy it is to create a Windows Server container?
Sure, I'd be glad to. Now, normally I do my container demos using Docker, but this time I'm going to use PowerShell.
Okay.
So the first thing I'm going to do is start a container here. You can see start container. I'm going to call it CTN1 for container one.
And what's this container going to run on?
Now, this container is going to run on Nano Server, which is a minimal installation of Windows specifically optimized to host containers.
And it's a headless deployment, so you're going to have to manage that remotely.
That's right. In fact, I'm going to be using PowerShell remoting here in a second, but let's just make sure that our container launched by typing get container. You can see that it's there running. And now let's connect into that using PowerShell remoting. And once we're in it, I'm going to take a look around at some aspects of the environment, and then we're going to compare that with what we see outside on the host, which is where we're coming from.
Okay.
So first thing let's do is take a look at the IP address, because each container gets its own IP address. And you can see here that the last part of the IP address is 193. Let's remember that when we get back out to the host.
So even though it's a container, it's isolated from the namespace perspective, it can still interact with the network.
It can, right.
Okay.
And then let's take a look at the process list. And this will highlight two things here. One is that it's because it's Nano Server, it's a very small list of processes compared to a full installation of Windows. But the second thing let's take a look at here is this process, CSRSS, which was one of the Windows system processes. You can see its process ID is 6528. And this CRSS is specific to this container. It's running inside the container. And that's going to be interesting when we get out of the container. Let's exit it and take a look at those aspects of the environment from the host perspective. If I take a look at the IP address here, you can see we've got a different IP address in the host. And when I do a get process, you'll see that the list is much, much longer. And if I try to filter and take a look at just the CSRSS processes, sr.name equals CSRSS, that we saw in the container, and that was process ID
6528,
and so that
this will confirm whether you're telling the truth or not.
That's right. So we can see that CSRSS from outside the container, but you notice that inside the container we saw none of these other CSRSSs.
Yep, that makes sense. So it seems pretty simple and fast to create a container. I'm guessing you can create lots of containers very quickly.
I can. I'm glad you asked, because I'm going to launch 5 new containers of the same type right here.
All from that same base
image? All from the same base image. And this will just take a few seconds, and now we'll have a total of 6 containers once this command completes.
So I noticed one of the commands there is the switch name, virtual switch, is using some of the Hyper-V technology investments we've made in the platform.
Exactly. That's how these containers are going to connect to the network.
Okay. So they look like they're starting pretty quickly.
So you can see that the script printed the status of each container, and it shows us off. And that's just because when the script terminated, the containers were starting up. Now you can see that they're all running. And there's my original CTN01, and then you can see the other 5 that I just launched.
But all from that same base image.
All from the same base image.
Excellent. So that's it's generating a lot of efficiency as well, you know, using that same.
That's right. It might be an example. I've got a front end that I need to scale out, and so I'm scaling them out dynamically.
Like a web front end, a web server.
That's right.
Okay. So all that seems pretty simple and quick to create containers, but you guys in Azure then must be thinking, this is actually pretty cool stuff for us.
It is really cool for us to be able to create applications made of containers like this. But we also have scenarios where these types of containers don't meet our needs.
Okay.
So example of that is that we host what we call hostile multi-tenant code. And that means code from customers that might not be friendly to us or to other customers. And we need to put that code in a very strongly isolated environment. And we've been using virtual machines to do that. But what would be ideal is to have lightweight containers to host that kind of code.
So get the benefit of containers, but the
isolation.
Additional benefit of isolation. Yeah.
So what we've done is created Hyper-V containers, which is another type of container that can run the exact same code or images inside of them and have the strong isolation guarantees of Hyper-V. The difference between Hyper-V containers, the key difference between Hyper-V containers and Windows Server containers is that with Hyper-V containers, besides being isolated with Hyper-V, they get their own optimized installation of Windows running inside of them as the host for the single container that they run inside them as well.
So we've seen you spin up a Windows Server container, so now we can see you spin up a Hyper-V container.
Sure, let's take a look. So I'm back on that same host, and what I'm going to do is stop that container that we just launched, that CTN01 that we launched earlier. And now that it's stopped, let's take a look at the container type by doing a get container, and we'll print out runtime type here, and you can see it's default.
Default being Windows Server containers.
That's correct. What we're going to do is switch the type to Hyper-V on the fly by doing set container on it. And now if we do the same command to see what type it is, you can see it switched to Hyper-V. Now when I start that container, it's going to be running in that isolated mode we just talked about. So let's start it up. And you can see I'm launching the exact same image. The only change I made was to the type of the container.
So if I'm a developer, I've built my app, I've containerized it, I don't have to do any extra work.
No extra work. You get the compatibility, that's a dynamic decision, the deployment time decision as to whether you need that isolation or don't.
And from an IT perspective, so that deployment decision might rest with them, all I have to decide is essentially that runtime type.
That's right. And one example would be IT says that for compliance or regulatory reasons, we need to have this app strongly isolated. We don't have to put it in its own virtual machine. We can put it in a Hyper-V container.
Okay, so it's great for IT because it's no extra learning apart from that single command. Yeah. And it's great for the developer because they don't have to change their application. So benefits all around. So how do you know, can we see both containers now if you've got them?
Yeah, let's take a look at some aspects of the environment of the Hyper-V container. And then again, look at what we see out on the host, because there is a difference from what we saw with the Windows Server container.
Right.
So let's enter it with PowerShell. And let's take a look at the process list like we did before. Again, this is Nano, and you can see here that we've got a CSRSS. This time it's process 8080. Mm-hmm. So let's exit that PS session, go back out to the host, and this time let's just look to see if we see. If we see that process 8080 out here on the host. So here are all the processes, the CSRSS processes, and you can see 8080 is missing from the list. And that's because that CSRSS is running inside that Hyper-V environment and it's not visible from outside in the host.
Right, so that's intentional.
Yep.
Excellent. So that demonstrates the isolation, the extra level of isolation for that particular container type. We've talked about the benefits. Great for IT because no change between Windows Server and Hyper-V containers from their deployment, apart from the single command. For the developer, no change in building the application. But can we see both of them together? Are we able to take a look and distinguish them?
Yeah, so first what I'll show you is the fact that this isn't a virtual machine. This Hyper-V container we just launched isn't a virtual machine. And so the PowerShell virtual machine management APIs don't show it.
Right.
But if we use that get container API like we did before, we're going to see those six containers, the one that I just launched, as well as those five I created before. You can see those five I created before are Windows Server containers, the default runtime, and the one I just launched is a Hyper-V container, managing them the exact same way.
Okay, so we've covered Windows Server and Hyper-V containers, but what are Azure's plans going forward for containers?
Yeah, we want to make sure that Azure is the best place to run containers. And one of the things we've done recently is announced the Azure Container Service, which is managing Mesos clusters. We've been working with Mesosphere to make sure that Mesos can host both Linux containers as well as Windows Server and Hyper-V containers. In addition, we're taking advantage of Hyper-V containers with some of those multi-tenant scenarios I talked about, like Azure Automation and machine learning, so customers can run their code in a much lighter weight environment for us.
Great stuff. Thanks, Mark. So if you want to experience containers, try the technical preview of Windows Server today, and keep checking Microsoft Mechanics Wednesdays or as news breaks for the latest updates. Thanks for watching.